We begin our worship this Maundy, Thursday, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to struggle against sin, death, and the devil. All that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is the struggle to which we were called at baptism. Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor, and enter the celebration of the great 3 days reconciled with God and with one another. We take a moment for a silent prayer. Please join me. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you. Let's join together in the prayer of the day. Eternal God, in the sharing of a meal, your Son established a new covenant for all people. And in the washing of feet, he showed us the dignity of service. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these signs of our life in faith may speak again to our hearts, feed our spirits, and refresh our bodies. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading this Maundy Thursday is from the 12th chapter of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." The word of the Lord. Our second lesson is from the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians. The Apostle Paul writes, "Now in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For to begin with, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And to some extent, I believe it. Indeed, there have to be factions among you, for only so will it become clear who among you are genuine. When you come together, it is not really to eat the Lord's Supper. For when the time comes to eat, each of you goes ahead with your own supper, and one goes hungry, and another becomes drunk. What? Do you not have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you not show contempt for the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What should I say to you? Should I commend you? In this matter, I do not commend you. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel is found in John, the 13th chapter. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not now know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I have said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen. Maundy Thursday is the night that we talk most about the Last Supper, Jesus' final get-together with his apostles and disciples. And he knew that this was going to be the last time. And he was, like so many teachers and parents at the last minute, trying to push into them and remind them of everything important that he had tried to teach them over the last several years. He talks to them about many, many things, but he keeps coming back to the same theme, and that theme is love and community. All of the lessons that we have for today are structured in community. At this time when we are socially distanced and maybe even isolated and not seeing other people at all, it's hard to think of ourselves as a community. And thinking about being together can make things seem even more lonely. But Jesus is reminding his disciples through this talk that we are always a community. The lesson in Exodus, where the angel comes and tells Moses that the people need to gather, they're saved in households. They come together as families, as households, and they stay together in order to be safe. As I was reading that, I was reminded of so many families at St. Stephen and around the world who are gathered together in our homes, staying together, staying inside, maybe eating more meals together than we've eaten together for the last year and a half. But they're together in order that we stay safe. The Old Testament text tells us that the angel of death came and went through the cities of Egypt, passing over those homes that had been marked with the blood of the Lamb. It sounds like a description of disease and plague. And as I read it and as I read commentaries and I thought about it, I thought, you know, that sounds so much like what we're going through. We are all marked with the blood of the Lamb, marked with the cross of Christ, His forever. And as we gather in our homes, knowing that around us there are viruses and disease that we can't see and can't explain and don't really know where they are, many of us are afraid. Some of us are scoffers. But there we are, together, in our families. Jesus takes that metaphor of family and he extends it from simply those who are in one household to all of those who believe in him and trust in him. Paul reminds us in Corinthians that it's easy for us to divide among ourselves. The divide that Paul is looking at is between those who are well off and those who are less well off. And as I watch the news and see what's going on around me, I see that divide too. There are those who have the material wealth that they are able to perhaps go to a vacation home or a cabin and be there isolated. There are those of us who may not have a more isolated place to go to, but have our own home where we are able to stay with our family and children. And there are those who are not able to stay at home, who, you know, some through a calling, perhaps of medicine or caring for others, but some through economic necessity are having to go out and risk themselves and their family's health in order to survive. That divide that Paul talks about between rich and poor is still there. But Paul tells us, you know, don't let that economic reality divide the community. Jesus reminds us that the essence of being part of the community of Christ is that we love one another as he loved us. That last night with his disciples, he showed them so many ways to show the love that we have for each other. He reminded them that his sacrifice that he was making for them was a sign of love. He gave them the Last Supper, the Holy Communion, a sign of love that would bring us together with Christians around the world for the next 2,000 years. And he washed their feet, reminding them that acts of service are a sign of love. This Maundy Thursday, we are gathered together in our households and our families. We're separated from the rest of the body of Christ. But we still hold each other in love. For some of us, that Love is shown through acts of service and caring. For some, it's shown through staying home and not endangering those who are weaker. But through all of this, our model of love is Jesus, who came so that he would give himself for us, the great model of love. Amen. Let us join together confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, almighty creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us join together in prayer. There'll be a pause so that you may name out loud those for whom you would like to pray. And after each petition, I will end, "Hear us, O Lord," and your response is, "Your mercy is great." Turning our hearts to God, who is gracious and merciful, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of love, unite your church in its commitment to humble service. Make us your faithful disciples. Speak words of truth and grace through us. Encourage us in self-giving acts of kindness. Let us love one another as you have loved us. Hear us, O God. God of love, tend to flocks, fields, and vineyards. Bring favorable weather for crops to grow. Guide the hands of those who cultivate, farm, and garden. Let the earth flourish so that all may eat and be satisfied. Hear us, O God. God of love, you give us a new commandment to have love for one another. We give thanks for organizations that respond to disasters and for agencies that offer relief and humanitarian aid to populations in need. Hear us, O God. God of love, give ear to all who call upon you for any need of body or spirit, especially Lois Brosi, Cleo Nimi, Jim and Laurel Pearson, Don Bendixson, Owen Ruth, Mary Jo Freshwater and family, Butch Carlin and family, and all of those whom we name at this time. Provide for those who do not have enough to eat, those who are unemployed or underemployed, and those who rely on the generosity of others. Hear us, O God. God of love, you invite us to your table of mercy. Heal all divisions between members of this assembly. Extend the hospitality of this table beyond these walls, that your love and welcome be made known to all. Hear us, O God. According to your steadfast love, O God, hear these and all our prayers as we commend them to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.